Nations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories, we tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
This is the Philippines.
And we are ANC.
Good morning, I'm Mike Navallo.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, a Philippine Senate panel recommends charges against several personalities linked to the Duterte government's allegedly anomalous supply deals with formerly pharmaceutical corporation.
The Philippine Justice Department authorizes the release of some information on the 52 drug war cases being reviewed by government.
The new management of the Benguet Electric Cooperative orders its employees to return to work following the government's takeover of the firm. We speak with Attorney Omar Mayo of the National Electrification Administration and suspended Beneco Board President Attorney Esteban Somngi later on the program.
And FBI agents raid the homes of a Russian billionaire with ties to the Kremlin.
Thanks for joining us. The Senate Blue Ribbon Committee recommends charges against several personalities linked to the Duterte government's allegedly anomalous supply deals with formerly pharmaceutical corporation. Topping the initial findings is former presidential economic advisor Michael Yang, who the panel once slapped with several cases and to be deported as an undesirable alien. It recommended filing charges of perjury against him, as well as formerly officials Lincoln Ong and Crizel Mago. Meanwhile, Yang and former budget official Christopher Lau were allegedly found to have violated the Anti-Graft and Corrupt Practices Act. The other recommended charges against formerly in budget officials include estafa, fraud, falsification of public documents, and violation of the Bayanihan to Hilas One Act. Committee Chairman Senator Richard Gordon vows to push through with the investigation despite President Duterte's attempts to derail the proceedings. Some health workers also staged a protest outside the Senate on Tuesday to show support for the probe.
Ito po ay panimula pa lamang, hindi katapusan po ito. Ito po lang po ang unang yugto ng pagpapanagot ng mga taong nangahas, magnakaw sa kaban ng bayan habang nasa gitna tayo ng karimlan ng pandemic. Sinusubukan po nila ngayon pagtakpan ang kanilang karumaldumal ng mga krimen.
We want to know the truth, and the people deserve to know the truth. Therefore, we decry any attempts to withhold testimonies and cover up what really happened. We would like to call on the president not to obstruct the testimony of material witnesses to any investigations.
The Senate Blue Ribbon Committee also cited formerly executives Mohit and Twinkle Dargani in contempt for their failure to submit subpoena documents from their firm. Senators believe those documents will show how formally profited from its deals with the government, despite sourcing the items it supplied from other companies. Part of the contempt order is to detain the siblings in Senate premises as the hearings continue.
Kahit paulit-ulit po natin tanungin ang mga involved, Mr. Chairman, kung hindi po natin makikita yung mga source documents, ang missing link po natin is yung 7.2 billion purchases, totoo ba ito? Nasaan ang dokumento na nagsasabi? At sino ang mga nag-supply? Paano sila binayaran? at paano ito na-deliver sa kanila, kasi po wala po tayong mga dokumento.
We suspect that, you know, there is a lot of questions that can be raised here, as this is the basis of the income taxes, and, you know, I don't want to say this, but this could reveal a lot of things about expenses which cannot be supported. That is why we need the subsidiary ledgers, the sales invoices, official receipts, the list of sales, and the subsidiary ledgers for these purchases, the delivery receipts, the sales invoice, all of this are needed to show that indeed the financial statements can be supported.
Mohit Dargani, meanwhile, defended his decision to refuse submitting the needed documents.
We are protected under the law, which I believe we're using our rights, that our legal counsel has responded to the committee. I am not refusing. It's the company that's refusing to provide these documents. At the same time, these documents are legally accessed through different procedures under the law, and we are just invoking our right.
Senator Richard Gordon also implicating President Duterte himself in the formality controversy. Gordon accused Duterte of being behind what he called a grand conspiracy to steal money intended for the purchase of pandemic supplies.
This grand conspiracy could never have happened without the imprimatur of the executive from beginning to end, from meetings with Farmali to the appointments of selected people who are extremely loyalty to him is the basis for the appointment and not competence.
Meanwhile, in a tape address aired Tuesday evening, Duterte again dismissed the Senate's probe into formally as nothing more than a political stunt ahead of the 2022 elections.
Problema kasi sa Senate natin, trying hard maghanap ng mga isyo na may nangungurakot, stop using this issue in aid of election. Bring your arguments to the proper court and I will answer you. Hinahamon ko kayo. Gawin ninyo yan.
The Philippines logged over 4,400 new COVID infections on Tuesday, the lowest daily tally since July 28. The health department admits the relatively low number is due to lower lab output. 211 more deaths and over 9,000 recoveries were also reported. Active cases now stand at 63,000, the lowest since August 4. But private hospitals say they're still seeing an increase in admissions, particularly moderate and severe COVID-19 patients.
Kung makikita nyo, bumaba po ang ating active cases, ano? Pero yung pong porsyento o percentage ng mga nako-confine as moderate, severe, and critical, tumaas po yan. Kasi nga po, pagbaba nung total na active cases naman, yung porsyento po ng mga moderate, severe, and critical, tumaas. Ibig sabihin po, hindi nagbabago yung mga naho-hospitalize sa ating mga private facilities. Medyo nako-control naman po, but then hindi po ibig sabihin ay maluwag na, no?
The Philippine government expands its COVID-19 alert level system to areas outside of Metro Manila. Starting today, Negros Oriental and Davao Occidental will be under alert level 4. Areas under alert level 3 include Cavite, Laguna, Rizal, and Davao City. Nearly a dozen areas are placed under alert level 2, including Batangas, Quezon Province, Bohol, Cebu City, and Davao de Oro. The new alert levels will remain in effect until October 31st.
Well, ito naman po ay kabahagi pa rin ng pilot study. Kung mapapansin niyo po, ilang rehiyon pa lamang ang na-include dito sa pilot study. Pero sabihin na po natin na yung pagbaba po ng mga kaso at saka yung pag-improve ng ating healthcare utilization rate ay parang may kinalaman po doon sa alert level system na inadapt natin sa Metro Manila, dahilan para palawagin pa natin yung ating pilot implementation.
The different alert levels allow more establishments to operate at varying capacities. Metro Manila was recently downgraded to alert level 3 following a decline in daily COVID-19 cases.
The Philippines looking to further ramp up COVID-19 vaccinations. Vaccine Chief Carlito Galvez Jr. says the government wants to be able to inoculate at least 1.5 million Filipinos per day before Christmas. Galvez did not mention the average daily vaccination rate, but data from Reuters showed the Philippines averages about 374,000 doses daily.
So to achieve a safe Christmas and national election, so our objective is to vaccinate at least 50 million of priority population before Christmas. And then all the NCR 10, the key cities, at least 70% fully vaccinated before the end, before Christmas. And also vaccinate at least 70% of the total population before the election period.
As of October 18th, nearly 24.5 million Filipinos have been fully vaccinated against COVID. That's 31.76% of the government's target population by the end of the year.
In other news, the Department of Justice authorizes the release of some information on the 52 drug war cases being reviewed by government. The DOJ says this is to inform the suspects' families that the cases are undergoing a determination of possible criminal liabilities on the part of erring policemen. It's also meant to invite any witnesses to come forward to the National Bureau of Investigation. The National Union of People's Lawyers welcomes this development, but it says the DOJ's move may also be viewed as simply going through the motions instead of a sincere resolution to halt violent deaths in the drug war. President Rodrigo Duterte told the United Nations last month that a review of his drug war was underway, days after the International Criminal Court announced it would be formally investigating it. And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, Philippine Energy Chief Alfonso Cusi and businessman Dennis Uy face graft charges over the sale of a 45% stake in the Malampaya Gas Project.
And FBI agents raid the homes of a Russian billionaire with ties to the Kremlin. These are more when the rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Hello, Washi! Laundry day na naman!
Yay! Anong meron?
Manchalan chocolate, oh. Butik, may libag pa!
Kaya natin yan!
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back to The Rundown. The headlines across the web. Iguara's banner story online, the Justice Department releasing information on the 52 cases involving deaths linked to the government's anti-drug war. Philippine Star's top story, over 8 million COVID-19 vaccines expected to arrive by the end of the year. Manila Bulletin's headline, Metro Manila logging its lowest COVID-19 reproduction rate in 5 months. Stopping GMA News' website, the COVID-19 Interagency Task Force mulls giving incentives for vaccinated individuals. NCNN Philippines' banner story, the alert level system now being implemented in some provinces. In other news, power play at a power cooperative in Benguet. More than 50 police officers stormed the office of the Benguet Electric Cooperative in Baguio City at 3 a.m. on Monday, October 18, to impose a preventive suspension order against its president, board of directors, and general manager following their refusal to recognize the new general manager appointed by the National Electrification Administration, Attorney Ana Marie Rafael. Four lawmakers have sought an explanation from the Interior Secretary and the police chief as to why the operation had to be conducted at such an hour, why the police had to be heavily armed, and why they supposedly barricaded the premises of the Bineco office, not even allowing the entry of Bineco's own employees. The takeover has led to the closure of Bineco's South Drive office today. But the new management warned some employees who have gone on strike to return to work or face sanctions. What led to this situation? We are joined this morning by Omar Mayo, the NEA project supervisor for Bineco. And later, we'll also hope to talk to suspended Bineco board president Esteban Somni. Attorney Mayo, thanks for joining us. Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Now, Attorney Mayo, let me begin with the reason for the, quote, forcible takeover of Bineco at dawn on Monday, accompanied by 50 policemen. Forcible takeover is how Baguio City Mayor Benjamin Magalong described it.
With all due respect to the Honorable Mayor, he came at around 7 o'clock in the morning of Monday. He was with us. Mm-hmm. And he just, in front of us, he said, just continue the service because you now have control of the main office of Bineco.
Yes, but what would justify the forcible takeover? Do you agree that it was a forcible takeover?
I would respectfully take exception to the said term forcible takeover, because there was a galvanized sheet that was supposed to be taking the place of a broken door, and it was there that I entered. I just had to push the table and then enter the premises. And allegedly, there were some breakages. There was inspection conducted by the police in the morning of Monday, October 18, and there were no breakages.
You mean to say, sir, you were able to enter the office without breaking the door, without opening the door?
There was, as I said, a galvanized sheet that I just had to push to enter.
When you say galvanized sheet, where was this placed? In the gate?
Front door.
Front door? There was a So you're saying you did not break anything, but you just pushed aside the galvanized sheet.
That's right.
But sir, when you have 50 police officers, can you confirm you were accompanied by 50 police officers?
We had some police officers. The police officers were mostly for purposes of civil disturbance, just for the keeping the peace. And some, a few, for security, a security contingent.
And why at 3 a.m.?
I had to leave that, sir, respectfully, to the discretion of the police officers during our briefing.
Because it was their decision.
It was agreed upon because I am not privy to possible intelligence reports that they may have.
Oh, sir, but why not wait for the officers of Bineco to actually arrive at the office and talk to them and tell them that you are now being installed as the project supervisor for Bineco from the NEA? Why resort to this raid?
Sir, I have been installed as early as September 28. Earlier than that, the order is dated earlier than that. But The order suspending Engineer Licoben and the seven directors were served on September 28th. So they knew that for a fact. Mm-hmm. Yet, we did not go to that extent. I held back because they were saying they had a petition filed with the Court of Appeals. Mm-hmm. I gave them all of 3 weeks to secure a temporary restraining order. Also, the petition was filed way back in August.
Mm-hmm.
It's so been almost 2 months from now. There is no official notice to NEA of the said petition because the rules would say before you file, you have to furnish the other party. We have not received any official notice from them.
So what is the root cause of this conflict, sir? Is it the refusal of the board to recognize you and the new general manager?
Yes, partly because mm-hmm. it is rooted in the appointment by NEA of Attorney Rafael. Mm-hmm. I was engaged only for the purpose of the being the project supervisor.
Mm-hmm.
And it appears that NEA based its decision to appoint Attorney Rafael on the decision, on the opinion, sorry, of the Government Corporate Council.
The Government Corporate Council. Sir, let's talk about that in a bit, the appointment of Attorney Rafael by the NEA. But there are some questions surrounding, for example, the recognition of the general manager. If the board, the Beneco board, does not recognize the new general manager, is that reason enough to preventively suspend the entire board of Beneco?
Sir, let me get the facts straight.
Mm-hmm.
The issue on the propriety of the appointment of Attorney Rafael is pending with the courts. Respectfully, sir, mm-hmm. I would like to decline answering that
mm-hmm.
on the ground of sub judice.
All right.
On the statement that the entire board has been suspended, it's not that accurate because only seven were ordered suspended.
There are still four who are mm-hmm. functioning as the as the Beneco board.
All right. So you're saying that seven board members were preventively suspended plus the general manager, right? Attorney Somi.
But
is there refusal? All right. Is there refusal to recognize the new general manager basis enough for preventive suspension?
That is the order because that is the need of resolution number 2021-87, which was served upon them way back in on September 28, 2021.
All right. Now, I know that you cannot answer some of the questions about the appointment of the general manager, but can I ask you factual questions? These are factual
yes,
questions, not in litigation. So let me begin with, let's start with the membership. Is she a member? Is Attorney Rafael a member of good standing of the cooperative for 5 years?
I do not have any information on that, sir. I'm sorry.
You don't have information?
Yes. I guess it was part and parcel of the background investigation done in the process of selection.
Is she a resident and consumer in the district?
Again, I would defer to those who did the background investigation, sir. Right.
And has she attended at least 2 annual general membership meetings?
I gave the same answer.
But, all right, let me rephrase my question.
As a lawyer, I think the residency requirement and the ACMA attendance requirement is needed for the appointment of a board director.
It also says officer, sir. The law actually says also the appointment of an officer.
That is very good. That is a very good question. Because when it says officers, it refers to the officers of the board.
Meaning officers of the board.
President, yes. The board president, vice president, secretary, treasurer, and other officers that may be elected by the board. It does not refer to the general manager, sir.
Sir, but logically, if you require your board members to be of a certain we have certain membership under the Bineco. If they have to be members of Bineco, they have to be part of that district, of that cooperative. Why not the general manager?
I think the law is clear on that. When it refers to officers, it refers to the officers of the board.
All right.
Now, I can cite to you several instances where there are general managers holding the position, but they definitely would not be residents of two places at the same time. There are two persons who are holding the position of a general manager of two electric cooperatives at the same time. And that explains the reason why the term officers does not include the general manager, sir.
But just to be factual about it, is she or was she a resident of Baguio City before her appointment?
As I said, sir, that is better addressed to the persons who did the background investigation. I am just citing examples that would lead us to conclude that the term officers would not refer to the general manager.
Oh, that's right, sir. All right. I mean, that's perfectly fine. But just, I'm just asking if personally, if you know Attorney Rafael, if she is a resident of Baguio City, if you don't want to answer that, that's fine, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, does the NEA have the power to appoint a general manager, sir?
Based on that resolution, sir, I think the resolution would speak for itself. That's resolution 2021-87.
But what is the legal basis for the resolution, sir?
I think the document would speak for itself. I can send you, I can ask our...
I saw the copy, sir. I saw the copy of that. But is there any legal provision that is the basis for the NEA appointing a general manager of a cooperative?
Would that not be sub judice, sir? Because I think that is the issue pending with the Court of Appeals.
No, sir. I'm just asking for the legal provision. If, you know, if it's at Section 4A, for example, the supervisory powers of the NEA over electric cooperatives, that's under the NEA Reform Act of 2003.
I would rather err on the side of caution, sir, than answer that question, because this may be intricately interwoven in the petition filed by Engineer Licoven.
Okay, can you tell us more about that petition?
What's
the nature of that?
I did not read the petition. It is basically a petition filed under Rule 43, a petition for review, questioning the resolution of NEA appointing Attorney Rafael. Mm-hmm. I think that is the gist of the petition.
Yeah, and I'm hoping to get the NEA side on this. That's why I'm asking you, sir. So I was hoping to get an explanation from the NEA side. What was the legal basis for appointing a general manager?
Yes, as I said, sir, respectfully, it may be intricately interwoven in the said petition.
All right, now.
So I'll leave it to the court to decide, sir.
All right. Attorney Mayo, what is the business of the NEA in taking over an electric cooperative that is not an ailing cooperative? Because according to Mayor Magalong himself, Bineco is the benchmark of the performance of electric cooperatives in the country. So in his words, why fix something that is not broken?
Thank you for that question, sir. The basis for that is the supervisory powers of NEA.
Mm-hmm.
Simply because the government has so much stake in the rural electrification program. It may also be a good opportunity now to inform the public that the government, because of its social contract with the people, is obligated to provide electricity, not only to the city centers and the municipios or the poblaciones. It has gone out to the barangays. Further, it will now go to the sitios. During the time of the during the administration of the late President Noynoy Aquino, the sitio electrification program was funded by government subsidy in billions of pesos.
And this is the stake of the government in rural electric cooperatives. Aside from the fact, of course, that electric cooperatives derive their authority to distribute power from the government. It's commonly referred to as a franchise. It is a privilege to distribute power. And that authority is delegated by the government, granted by the government, in favor of electric cooperatives.
Attorney Mayo, if I may just cite the provision under the NIA Reform Act on step-in rights of the government, and it refers specifically in cases of ailing cooperatives. Are you invoking this provision that the ailing cooperative allows the NIA to actually take over?
No, sir. That is, I think, Section 4B.
Yes.
No, we are talking about Section 4A.
Mm-hmm.
4A. Because no electric cooperative, as of the time I speak, and to the best of my knowledge, has been formally declared as an ailing cooperative. Yet, there are several electric cooperatives that are assigned with a project supervisor or an opting general manager. Or in some cases, the project supervisor and the acting general manager position are rolled into one person. So we have a PS, we have an AGM, or we have a PS-AGM. Simultaneously, he is the project supervisor and the acting general all rolled into one. Let's take, for example, the Cordilleras.
Mm-hmm.
There was a project supervisor for ABRA, ABRECO, yet it has not yet been formally declared an ailing electric cooperative. We have one NEA guy in IFELCO, Ifugao Electric Cooperative. He is the PS and the AGM at the same time, yet Ifugao IFELCO is not an ailing electric cooperative.
Are they similarly situated, sir, compared to Benguet Cooperative? Because Mayor Magalang is saying that Beneco is doing well, even if it's far from being ailing.
Precisely. It is one of the better cooperatives. But there are adverse audit findings, and I will be more than willing to give you the adverse audit findings. You can just send me your email address and I will ask our secretary, corporate secretary, to send you a copy of the adverse audit findings.
All right, I'll do that, sir. But I'm reading Section 4A, paragraph B of the law on NEA. And it says here, although NEA may appoint, may suspend, may remove and replace any or all of the members of the board of directors and officers, but there is a qualifier phrase, sir, to attain the objectives of this act. And as you mentioned, total electrification of the country, but also operational viability of that company. That's in the objectives of the law. Are you saying that there is a problem when it comes to the operational viability of Beneco that would actually allow NEA to step in?
Yes, this is borne out by two audit reports, both adverse. Mm-hmm. At NEA, sir, we have color-coded reports. Blue, as far as I know, it's blue for almost perfect compliance. Violet for those in the middle, with a slight or more than slight modifications that may be needed. Mm-hmm. And red for those with gravely adverse audit findings. For two past audit periods, meaning 3 years, there have been red reports for Beneco.
All right, sir. I'll wait until I'll see that document and we'll ask you again about this issue. All right. Thank you, Attorney Mayo, for joining us.
Yes, sir. May I just clarify?
Go ahead, sir. Go ahead.
You mentioned a while ago, and I would like to clarify that the employees were not barred. In fact, just to belabor the obvious, the employees, some employees, were seen by myself congregating at the parking area, while a number of employees were able to enter the building itself and registered for duty, meaning they registered their forefingers at the biometric machine. That simply debunks the allegation that they were barred from entering. And neither did the policemen present thereat bar the entry, because we had instructions for the police to allow the employees of the electric cooperatives to report for work. After congregating at the parking area, they opted to proceed to downtown area for their mass action.
All right, sir. And just to be clear also, that allegation about the police barricading Bineco premises and preventing some employees from coming inside was taken from the letter of four party list representatives to the PNP chief and to the head of the DALG. So it's did not come from our reports.
I will have to take a look at that, sir. But categorically, as a government official, I am telling everybody that they were not barred.
All right. Thank you for the clarification this morning, Attorney Mayo.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, too.
In other news, presidential aspirant and Senator Manny Pacquiao will continue to give cash aid to Filipinos in need in the run-up to the 2022 elections. Pacquiao earlier drew flak after several videos showed he handed out cash to those who attended his political sortie in Batangas last week. Pacquiao's camp denies insinuations of vote buying, saying he was doing it out of charity.
Sabi nga niya, hindi naman siya titigil tutulong sa tao dahil ayaw ng ibang tao or binibigyan ng kulay. So wala pong violation dyan. Yan ang sabi niya. Attorney, hindi ako titigil gumawa ng kabutihan. Nangangailangan yung mga tao natin, nagugutom, nasalantat. At kung meron man silang gustong bigyan ng kulay, sila na po yun. Basta tayo po sa team po ni Senator Manny ay tumutulong po tayo sa tao.
A coalition of labor leaders backs Vice President Lenny Robredo's presidential bid for 2022. All for Lenny, or the Alliance of Labor Leaders for Lenny, believes Robredo will help them push for workers' rights, citing her track record. The group vows to deliver at least 2 million voters for the vice president on election day. It also hopes one of their members, Sonny Matula, will be included in Robredo's senatorial slate.
Mas mataas pa diyan kung susumahin. The membership of the All for Lenny includes about 350,000 workers, yung existing. But we are still expanding. We are recruiting other organizations in overseas. Tapos marami pa tayong mga organization na sa informal sector na hindi pa natin naisari dito sa ating computation.
In business, the International Monetary Fund cuts its 2021 growth forecast for Asia. It now sees the region growing 6.5%, down from its earlier estimate of 7.6%. But it raised its outlook for next year, citing progress on the COVID-19 vaccination front. The IMF warns a fresh wave of COVID infections, supply chain disruptions, and inflation pressures continue to pose downside risks to its outlook. It says the divergence between advanced and emerging economies in Asia is deepening, with Indonesia, Malaysia, the Philippines, Singapore, and Thailand still facing severe challenges. It adds any untimely policy normalization by the U.S. Federal Reserve could also trigger significant capital outflow and higher borrowing costs for emerging Asian economies.
Philippine Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi and Udena boss Dennis Uy faced a graft complaint before the Office of the Ombudsman. That's for Udena's buyout of Chevron's 45% stake in the Malampaya gas project. The complaint was lodged by concerned citizens who alleged that Cusi and other officials conspired to give Udena an undue advantage in the sale. Cusi has dismissed the complaint as a mere political propaganda. Udena now has a 90% stake in Malampaya after buying Shell's 45% stake earlier this year. The transactions were questioned in the Senate, but Cusi had denied that they were so-called midnight deals.
Yep. The Philippines has seen 8 straight weeks of fuel price spikes. Despite this, transport authorities are not keen on granting the request of jeepney groups for a hike in transport fares. Alvin Lachico tells us why.
Gasoline prices are now over 60 pesos per liter, while diesel has reached the 50 peso level in Metro Manila. In the provinces, fuel prices are more expensive in some areas based on photos and videos sent by bayan patrollers. After 8 straight weeks of fuel price spikes, diesel prices are now 8.50 pesos per liter more, while gasoline is over 7 pesos more expensive. Despite the staggering oil prices, government has yet to come up with concrete measures to help the transport sector. Jeepney groups filed a petition to raise the minimum fare by 3 pesos, but the regulator says it is unlikely to be approved.
Ang guidance po ni Secretary, kung pwede hindi magtataas ng pamasahe, kasi on one hand, we understand very much no the concern and the basis for the petition, pero kung papayagan po natin yung petition na yan, may matatamaan naman manamas nakakarami.
The Transportation Department will recommend increasing passenger capacity for public transport. Delgra says the House Transportation Committee has called for a hearing Wednesday to discuss ways to help drivers. Delgra adds fuel subsidies can be revived or discounts can be expanded for public utility jeepneys, but the problem is higher fuel prices in the international market are likely to stay until end of the year.
Hanggang end of this year, yung deficit na 2.91. But OPEC, based dun sa nakaraang meeting nila ng October 4, ang kainalang pwedeng i-release pa lang yung 400,000 barrels per month na mag-i-even out ang supply and demand by end of this year.
Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi has asked Congress to amend the oil regulation law to enable government to respond when fuel prices continuously spike. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
And we now continue our discussion on the takeover of the Benguet Electric Cooperative. Joining us is Attorney Esteban Somngi, the Beneco Board President, who was ordered preventively suspended by the National Electrification Administration. Attorney Somngi, good morning. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Sir Mike, and good morning to the listeners and viewers.
Attorney Somngi, Attorney Mayo, we just had him on earlier, and he refuses to actually characterize what happened to Beneco as a takeover. Do you agree it wasn't a forcible takeover?
I agree with that. It's a forcible takeover because, you know, these full battle gear police officers entered inside the headquarters, Beneco headquarters, at 3 o'clock a.m. Mm-hmm. And they went there with those number of police officers, almost 50. And wala namang tao doon eh. Parang pumunta sila sa Giera, Sir Mike. Yeah. It's a forcible takeover.
And he's saying he didn't actually break anything because he just pushed aside an iron sheet to be able to gain entry to the office. Is that how your office looks like? Isn't there a door to your office?
Sir Mike, hindi yan eh. Kasi nakikita natin sa video, merong mga nababasag and nababasag na glass. And even if there is no breakage of any doors, glass doors or whatsoever, bakit sila, why did they forcibly enter inside that premises, which is a private property, at 3 o'clock a.m. If they had a sufficient papers, court order whatsoever, they can enforce it at the at office hours. At hindi po ganyang ano ganyang oras na at 3 o'clock a.m. na everybody is sleeping and para silang ano eh para silang komando. Na eh, si Bin Laden nga eh 10 tao lang ang kumuha sa kanya eh diyan eh 50. Wala namang tao doon sir eh wala namang tao. What did they do that?
Sir, they're saying there is a NEA board authorization deputizing the police to actually enforce a preventive suspension order. Do you think there is sufficient legal basis for the NEA to actually authorize such deputization?
Well, pinakita sa amin yung papel na to enforce the suspension. Yun lang po, sir. Wala namang order to break open. Yun lang naman eh, and we can abide with that. At ito pa ah, yung suspension order 9 is a old story because in the annual general membership assembly that was recently held, the AGMA, the consumers, who is the yung sa hierarchy, they are the top decision making body, already reposed authority confidence to us to continue our function. So yung suspension order na yan is just an old story. And they can enforce in office hours. Hindi naman pwede na you barge inside the headquarters at 3 o'clock a.m. just to enforce that suspension order. It's an overkill, sir, Mike.
Yeah. And sir, let's go to the root cause of this. Is it accurate to say that the root cause was really your refusal, the refusal of the Benekco board to recognize the newly installed general manager appointed by the NEA? Is that an accurate description?
Very accurate, sir. Why? Because we voted, the seven board of directors voted to reject that NEA BOA appointed GM. What happens next? Ito na yung suspension namin. O kayo ah, kayong mga board ah, wag niyo hindi niyo gusto yung appointment in-appoint namin na GM ito suspended na kayo. Ganun ba?
And what is your objection, sir, to the appointment of Attorney Ana Marie Rafael as the new general manager?
Come again, sir?
What is your objection to the appointment of Attorney Ana Marie Rafael as the new general manager?
Wala namang bakante, sir, eh. Bakit hindi naman kayo po, hindi naman NEA ang may authority to appoint a GM. Under the bylaws, under the law, under the NEA Memorandum 2017-035, it is the board who has the authority to appoint a general manager of a electric cooperative.
Attorney Mayo is citing the supervisory powers of the NEA over electric cooperatives.
Well, supervisor power should be differentiated from the control. Ang supervisory power lang is to see to it that itong mga rules namin is makukomply. Yeah, but not to control. Di ba? Iba yung control sa iba yung supervisory eh. Ano ba yung sinasabi sa NEA Memorandum 2017-035? Ito yung mga requirements namin, itong mga requirements ng pag-appoint ng ano yung GM, you have to comply. And that's what we did. Pero anong ginawa nila? They control us. Ang gusto nila is ito yung gusto naming GM, which is hindi naman pwede.
Sir, let me just go through some of the qualifications of Attorney Rafael because under the law, there are some requirements for board members or officers of a certain electric cooperative. So is she a member of good standing of the cooperative for 5 years?
She's not, sir.
Is she a resident and consumer in the district?
She is not.
Has she attended at least 2 annual general membership meetings?
She did not.
And Attorney Mayo refusing to actually answer this question and also insisting that those qualifications do not apply to a general manager because supposedly the officers described under the law refers to board of directors. Do you agree with that assessment?
I do not agree with that. And ito pa, Sir Mike, wala siyang qualification of 5 years experience to manage an electric cooperative. Pangalawa, dun sa UP exam nila, bagsak po siya. Yung UP, yung result, ang recommendation doon, not recommended to be a GM.
And so how was she appointed by the NEA?
I just don't know. Maybe because she's a former PCO.
So we have a former PCO assistant secretary trying to run an electric cooperative in Benguet. Is she a resident even of Benguet?
She's not a resident of Benguet. She's not a resident of Baguio City, sir. Yeah.
All right. Now let me go through. Let me go to the basis of NEA for appointing somebody else to actually run an electric cooperative. They're saying it's not ailing operations, but they're saying there are red flags in your audit reports. Tell us, how is Beneco doing financially?
Yung mga audit reports, we can comply with that. Diba? Kung meron mang mga red flags, okay, you comply with this audit report. Kung ano man yung pagkukulang, then you comply with this. And that is not a ground for them to forcibly enter. Okay, i-appoint nila yung sarili ng yung gusto nilang maging GM because Beneco is a top performing cooperative. Hindi po tayo ang pinakamababa ang rate ng kuryente for the 2 succeeding years. And hindi lang po tayo nasa distribution, we now extend our business sa generation. May mga hydro tayo na project, may mga solar power na project natin. So, ano bang problema doon? Kung yung audit report na yan, pwede natin i-comply yan.
Mm-hmm.
But not... Yes.
Go ahead, sir.
But not for them to appoint their own GM. Kasi mm-hmm. Ang ganda ng operation ng Beneco eh.
Now, is there any other basis?
What's the reason for them to appoint their own GM? A top performing nga ang Beneco. Diba? Hindi lang tayo nasa distribution. We extend our business, mag-generation project naman tayo. Diba? Doon mo makikita eh kung paano ang operation ng isang electric cooperative na hindi lang siya satisfied diyan sa distribution business.
Mm-hmm. Sir, is there any other basis to your mind for the NEA to actually take over your cooperative?
For me, wala pa pero mga ang daming haka-haka. Ayaw ko lang magsabi.
Sir, have you actually filed your petition with the CA, with the Court of Appeals, to question the appointment of General Manager? Because Attorney Mayo is saying they have not received any communication or document or any petition.
Sir, alam nila yan na merong kaso sa Court of Appeals. Alam nila yan. Pangalawa, may yung House of Representatives, Committee on Energy. May mga hearings yan. Sinasabi ang mga NEA, huwag muna kayong mag-act dyan kasi ito na nga, tinatackle namin itong problema dyan sa Beneco. And after that, they issued a resolution na ito ang nangyari dyan. So, ito, huwag muna kayong mag-action dyan. Pero, what did they do? Parang binaliwala nila yung co-equal body na it's a Congress pa yan na nagsabi na huwag muna kayong mag-action dyan at ito na rinirimedyohan natin kung ano man yung problema dyan. Pero what did
you do? Attorney Somni, the standoff has led to disruption of some services of Beneco with the South Drive office closed. Consumers will have to find somewhere else to pay their bills, do other transactions. Now, given this disruption, why are you standing your ground and shouldn't employees just go back to work?
Ito na ang ginawa nila. They forcibly open yung mga opisina natin, then they are collecting bills. Kaya nga meron tayong advisory kahapon na huwag muna kayong magbayad ng bills kasi ang mga yan hindi authorized. At of course, our primary concern is yung mga MCOs natin, yung mga consumers natin, and as early as possible, we have to go back to the operation. But not with them. We can do our job somewhere else, but not with them. Kahit sa kanila yung self-drive.
Mm-hmm. And what are your next steps, sir? Lastly, what are your next steps?
Well, hindi ko po sasabihin in public, but we have our steps. Aside from the legal, meron po tayong ginawa, pinaplano. Kasi ang ginawa nga nila parang ano eh, commando style na pag-attack sa headquarters natin, sa Bineco, and you know, Baguio Binget people are peace loving. Wala pong ganyan. It's the first time na may nangyari na ganyan, and of course the MCO will act. The consumers will act on that. Hindi po tayo, mga MCOs na po, sila na po ang voluntary na gagawa ng paraan dyan.
Alright, Attorney Esteban Somni, thank you for your time this morning.
Thank you, Sir Mike. Thank you.
And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
At least three have announced their respective presidential bids in 2022. More are expected to join next year's all-important race, and things are only starting to heat up. What are you seeing as far as his prospects of becoming a president? Is there a metric or a study to really show and measure the impact of social media?
Yes,
on what's the best way to fight political disinformation? The extension of voter registration, what is the status of that in the COMELEC?
Catch Tina Monzon Palma reports only here on ANC.
At a time when we are gripped by fear, we are inspired by your courage. At a time when we are in dire need of hope, we look up to your sense of duty and compassion. At a time when the default reaction is self-preservation, you put the needs of the sick above your own.